Right. This topic summarizes everything, comes to a conclusion about the technology arrangement. Now, we discussed in the previous lecture, previous set of slides, about the planning aspects and mostly about how you have to get prepared. Now, here we are going to talk about the technology awareness, basically. What are the different ways, or what are the preparations you have to do in terms of the technical architecture? Right. Successful implementation of e-business requires significant changes to existing business processes and substantial investment in IS technology. These technology components must be chosen carefully and be integrated to support a large volume of transactions with customers, suppliers, and other business partners worldwide. Right. In surveys, online consumers frequently note that poor website performance, example, slow response time, inadequate customer support, and lost orders, some of these issues, drives them to abandon some e-commerce websites in favor of those with better, more reliable performance. Right. So this is the context of why it is important to think about the technological aspects, right? Because these kind of issues are the ultimate things people face. So a fundamental infrastructure, key technology infrastructure components in e-commerce is you need to have web server hardware. On top of that, you need to have a proper server operating system and then a proper server software that could coordinate different type of workloads. On top of that, you have your e-commerce website or the software, and maybe in between, right? Yeah, okay. After e-commerce software, you need to have the high-speed connection, and then after this, maybe you need to have these this payment gateways where you have this transactions to work. So that. For that, you need to have the internet connectivity. You have to have an idea about what is VPN, value-added network. All these things need to be taken into consideration. So starting from the bottom layer, very bottom layer, a web server hardware platform complete with the appropriate software is a key ingredient to e-commerce infrastructure. The amount of storage capacity and computing power required of the web server depends primarily on two things. That means storage capacity and computer power is dependent on these two things. The software that must run on the server, the volume of e-commerce transactions that must be processed. That means we don't know how many people are going to connect to this. So we have to consider the volume. We have to consider a proper software that can support your e-commerce platform, right? So this will decide what kind of server, web server you're going to choose. The most successful e-commerce solutions are designed to be highly scalable so that they can be upgraded to meet unexpected user traffic. Okay. Key website performance measures include response time, transaction success rate, and system availability. Right. So these three points at the last I have colored here. So these three points are the real measurements that give you value to your e-commerce. So if you have a low response time, a very good transaction success rate, and more system availability, that means your system doesn't go down, your website doesn't shut down regularly. So if you don't have any of those problems, then it is a successful e-commerce platform. So these things are the key website performance measures. Maybe you can take a note of it later as well. A key decision facing a new e-commerce company is whether to host its own website or to let someone else do it. Many companies decide that using a third-party web service provider is the best way to meet initial e-commerce needs, as we discussed earlier. So the third-party company rents space on its computer system and provides a high-speed connection to the internet, thus minimizing the initial out-of-pocket costs for e-commerce startup. Okay, so they will provide the whole infrastructure, basically, not only the system, also the connectivity matters, everything they provide you. Simply, you have to just go and start up your business. That's it. So the third party can also provide personal train to operate, troubleshoot, and manage the web server. Even that part they can do, the supporting part. We may not have the expertise, we may not have the people, technical administrators on our side. So they will be the administrators. They can maybe give us some basic training on how to use the admin panel and stuff like that. Then the next layer is the web server software. Each e-commerce website must have web server software to perform fundamental services. Why web server software is needed? For security and identification, retrieval and sending of web pages, website tracking, website development, hosting, or even for web page development. We need a proper web server software. So today in the world, I think most popularly used web server software as Apache HTTP Server and IIS from Microsoft, Internet Information Services. It's more likely known as Microsoft IIS. So even in your local machine, if you are going to run a ASP.NET website, mostly it will be running on IIS. So IIS, just I will show you, for example, for Apache HTTP Server, you may need to download and use something. If you have already installed XAMPP, right, you will have this XAMPP control panel. And let me see. So if you're going to run a PHP website, you need to have this Apache HTTP Server or sometimes Tomcat Server as well. If it's a Java server page, you need a Tomcat server. But here you can see Apache. So currently it's off. I can switch it on if I want to run a PHP website on my machine. Basically, now my machine is going to serve like a server. In top of that, this is the web server software. Similarly, for IIS, if IIS doesn't work, the place you have to go is control panel. Control panel. There is a place called, let's go to programs. Turn Windows features on. Programmer features, you have this button called turn Windows features on off. I mean, these are not necessary for your syllabus, but I'm just giving you an idea. In case you are doing some web development, you should be aware of these things, these fundamental things. So in case if you want to have IIS enabled on your local machine, and you're doing something on a Visual Studio development environment, here you have to come and enable this thing, Internet Information Services. Right? You just have to enable that, and then you can start deploying ASP.NET or ASP.NET Core web applications and start testing. Okay, so that is about the web server softwares. So we have to have this idea. This is something very important for running the websites. Then on top of that, we have the e-commerce software itself, our website, basically our web pages. After you have located or built a host server, including the hardware, operating system, and web server software, you can begin to investigate and install e-commerce software to support 5 core tasks. So once you deploy your e-commerce software, these are the things we are going to do. Catalog management to create and update the product catalog. What do you mean by catalog management now? Let's say you are doing a retail store business, grocery shop, you have created an e-commerce platform. So you may have to add all information about whatever is there in the grocery shop, from onion, potato, pictures of potatoes, everything, price. So that is called catalog management. Then after that, you may do a product configuration to help customers select the necessary components and options. So you can, after you have filled the catalog, you can now categorize them. You can categorize them. What is vegetable? What is baby products? What is detergent products? Something like that. So that kind of configurations you can do. Then shopping cart facilities to track the items selected for purchase. So this is what we do additionally. Whatever the customers have bought. E-commerce transaction processing, you have to have a proper payment gateway configured, right? Maybe you may need to buy a payment gateway option from a particular bank. You may have to pay the money and get the API information. So they will provide one API that is directly connected to your savings account or your current account. So that will be solely for you. So that is a fourth step. Then web traffic data analysis to provide details to adjust the operations of the website. So that is another thing you can see in a e-commerce platform, as I discussed earlier, analytical information. For mobile commerce to work effectively, the interface between the mobile device and its user must improve to the point that it is nearly as easy to purchase an item on a wireless device as it is to purchase it on a PC. In addition, network speeds must continue to improve so that users do not become frustrated. So all this time we were talking about e-commerce platforms from the perspective of accessing it from a PC or a laptop, right? So performance might be very good. You will see good response times, no issues. But sometimes when you go to a mobile device and trying to access the same website, you may face a different set of challenges in terms of, mostly in terms of speed. So there might be a performance hit. There might be some issues with it. So to tackle that, you may need to come up with some shared design templates where it will load quickly on mobile devices as well as your PCs as well. So that's why we learn different UI frameworks such as Bootstrap and Flutter. There are a lot of new technologies available you can explore. These all try to, you know, reduce this kind of issues, right? So we have to be aware of that as well. Right. When you are using mobile devices for the commercial activities, security is also a major concern, particularly in two areas. The security of the transmission itself and the trust that the transaction is being made with the intended party. So encryption can provide secure transmission. Okay. What is encryption? Encryption means converting something into a format where others cannot understand. That is called encryption. So when you are sharing data, we need to think about encryption as well. So digital certificates can ensure that transactions are made between the intended parties. We'll discuss about digital certificates in a moment. Limitations of mobile devices. So when you're using mobile devices, the screens are generally small, right? And might be able to display only small portions of a website. In addition, entering data on mobile device can be tedious and error prone. You can make mistakes. Mobile devices also have less processing power and less bandwidth than its PC counterparts, which are usually connected to high-speed LAN. They also operate on limited life batteries. So these are some limitations we have to be aware of when people use mobile devices. So in this context only, you have to think. So for these reasons, web developers must often rewrite web applications so that users with mobile devices can access them without any frustration. Right? So it is a constant, so it's not just e-commerce platform is there up and running. As you know, more and more customers come in, there are a lot of opportunities to, you know, improve your website, and always there will be work for the web developers, web development team. They will always have some kind of work under this category. mostly in improving the website. Right. Then the other aspect on this technological framework is having this idea about electronic payment systems to do the transactions. So current e-commerce technology relies on user identification and encryption to safeguard business transactions. Actual payments are made in a variety of ways, including e-cash, e-wallets, and smart credit, charge, and debit cards. Websites that accept multiple payment types convert more visitors to purchasing customers than merchants who offer only a single payment method. So you have to have these varieties. You shouldn't, if you rely just only cash method for the thing, or maybe only credit card, maybe you will have only limited customers, because people who don't have credit cards may think, although everything is nice, the only way to pay is through credit card, means they will not come to your website. So you should have a variety of options of how the payments can be done. So you have to think of even manual things. So here we are discussing about only the online methods, but sometimes you may need to think about the traditional ones. Right? Now, I have seen that's what BIT also is doing at one aspect. Anybody can highlight where you have used a manual thing combined with the online platform when somebody involved with BIT? Can you give an example scenario? I'm sure there are a lot of people in this where you combined a manual process with you combine a manual process with the online one, with the BIT online platform. Do you remember some of you who did online registrations, isn't it? So for the online registrations, did you do the online payments? No, right? You did the payments at the bank. You took a snapshot of the snapshot or photocopy of the script, whatever, the receipt, and then you started uploading. Right? Imagine if that was not there, there is no way for BIT to realize that you have done the payment. Okay, that is one example, a very simple example, where they have combined manual methodology with the online platform. Anything else you can type in? We can discuss that. So that is one example I just highlighted for you to understand this in a simpler way. So what the key point here is, you have to have variety of options to do the payments. There are only a lot of customers. You can target diverse customers. Okay, digital certificates. What are these things doing in our electronic payment system? Authentication technologies are used by many organizations to confirm the identity of a user requesting access to information or assets. A digital certificate is an attachment to an email message or data embedded in a website that verifies the identity of a sender or website. The certificate authority is a trusted third-party organization or company that issues digital certificates. The CA means the Certificate Authority, is responsible for guaranteeing that the people or organizations granted these unique certificates are in fact who they claim to be. So digital certificates thus create a trust chain throughout the transaction, verifying both purchaser and supplier identities. Okay, so what is this jargon talking about? Now, you are in the website, you have signed in, logged into the e-commerce platform, you have added your shopping cart, all perfect. Now you are going to the point of making the payments. You click on the payments and you get the credit card stuff, or the credit card details are now appearing and you are starting to fill that. From that point onwards, when you submit, now there is a chance where an intruder can come in the between. A hacker can come in the middle and kind of divert your data into their database or whatever the tools they have, and maybe they will be contacting the payment gateway representing you. So what happens is ultimately you have bought the items officially through the e-commerce platform, but you haven't done the payments, but that person might be, you know, sending a small request to the bank, and he will also have your credit card information already saved. So there could be a problem happening like that. So to avoid that, what they do is, there are these certificate authorities. Certificate authorities, they issue digital certificates to the websites. So if your e-commerce is there, that's why you might have seen some lock sign, trusted website, when you are visiting some website, HTTPS, that kind of thing is there with the lock sign. Because the servers, they issue the digital certificates. Digital certificates are issued by some third party company. There are reliable companies. They certify that if a person is coming through this website, it is this person. They try to verify. They just don't do like that. There are a lot of algorithms working behind that, which I'll explain in the next slide briefly. So this is the idea. So when the payment gateway or the bank receives the request, when the request is coming from the e-commerce platform, they also will get the digital certificate information as well. Then they have a confidence, okay. Seeing the digital certificate, they will trust the transaction and enable the payment to happen, right? So this is what digital certificates do. It is like a authorized document kind of thing, e-document, right? Think it in that terms. So to briefly, at a very high level, to understand what happens in a digital certification stuff. Now imagine you have your data. This is the data I'm talking about, like for example, the purchase you have done through the shopping cart, number of items, all those blah blah details. So that will go through a hashing algorithm and encrypted using the user's private key, and a signature will be created. And then through your website, you already have a CA authority that has provided a certificate. So these two will be combined together and you will have a digitally signed data. This data reaches the target destination. In our case, let's say the banks. So now this digital signed data will be split into the data part and into the signature part. So the data part will be hashed again and some information will come. Another hash value will come. Then the signature part is taken using the user's public key. You will later learn what is private key, what is public key, and how those things are working. It's a separate topic to discuss, but just for your information. So there is a public key from the user's side. That public key will be used to decrypt this data and another hash will be created. If this hash and this hash matches, that means it is a trusted transaction. If these two don't match, then you can say it is a forgery. That means some hacker is trying to access data, and they will not proceed with the transaction. Because most likely, hacker can get control over this part, but this is very difficult to get from the hacker. Right? This, because digitally signed data is very secret to the user itself. So that's how online transactions are happening now. Okay, many organizations that accept credit cards to pay for items purchased via e-commerce have adopted the payment card industry security standard. This standard spells out measures and security procedures to safeguard the card issuer, the cardholder, and the merchant. Some of the measures including installing and maintaining a firewall configuration to control access to computers and data, never using software or hardware vendor supply default for system passwords. Now, most of these systems, when you're using most product, they give you a default password like admin 123, testing 123. People never change that after that, right? When you have those things for a long time, what happens is any hacker can come easily and take control over your password. This is what happens with Wi-Fi routers also. These companies issue the Wi-Fi routers for all users, almost all users, with the same password. And that's why even today when I go to some places in Putlam, I get free Wi-Fi connectivity, especially with SLT broadband. Reason being is it's the same password used throughout. So unfortunate, it's very unfortunate because people don't have knowledge about it. So never use default passwords. So that is one technique to make sure a safe transaction. And requiring merchants to protect stored data, encrypt transmission of cardholder information across public networks, use and regularly update antivirus software, and restrict access to sensitive data. So these are some measurements you can list out in point format. I haven't provided in point format, unfortunately. It would be nice if this is in a point format. So these are some measures you can take to, you know, prevent fraudulent activity over the internet before things go from your hand. Various measures are being implemented to increase the security associated with the use of credit cards at the time of purchase. So the address verification system is a check built into the payment authorization request that compares the address on file with the card issuer to the billing address provided by the cardholder. So this is, I think, something done today also. When you fill the credit card information online, they check it with the actual address that is there. Even the names, I think they check. Sometimes they check the card verification number. You know, those last 3 digits or 4 digits that are appearing in the in your credit card number, the last 3 digits, there might be the, that will be another way of verifying the card verification number. You know, Visa is a card, credit card company, issuing company. So Visa has advanced authorization, a Visa patented process that provides an instantaneous rating of the transaction potential for fraud. Using factors such as the value of the transaction, type of merchant, time of the day the purchase is being made, whether the site is one where the card owner has previously shopped, like these are some advanced ways of authorizing the user. The card issuer can then send an immediate response to the merchant regarding whether to accept or decline the transaction. That is why sometimes people who are using credit card transactions, when you're doing a purchase for large money, sometimes you get a call from the bank because they suspect why a lot of money is going through this. They just call to verify whether you are the person who has done that or not. Apart from that, multi-factor authentication schemes can be used, such as biometrics, one-time passwords, maybe even tokens, hardware tokens that plug into a USB port. That means there are special USB devices which serve as tokens. Now, without that token, maybe you may not be able to do the payment, something like that. Right. So these are some other techniques that people use to do a secure payment. The use of biometric technology to secure digital transaction has been slow to develop due to the cost and privacy concerns. Transport layer security is simply to understand the thing what you see in the website, in HTTPS or sometimes secure socket layer, SSL, right? So all online shoppers fear the theft of credit card numbers and banking information. To help prevent this type of identity theft, the transport layer security communication protocol is used to secure sensitive data. So TLS is a communication protocol or system of rules that ensures privacy between communicating applications and their users on the internet. TLS enables a client, like a web browser, to initiate temporary private conversation with a server, like a shopping site on the web or online bank. How many of you have online banking systems? The online systems with your saving accounts. Anybody using online? Commercial bank or Sampath or anything? Anybody using online systems, online transaction? No. Okay. If you install some smart software like Kaspersky antivirus software, when you visit a website, for example, if I visit a website, I mean, but banking online website, since banks are very sensitive and they have this TLS protocol already in place, you will notice that once I start this, once I give a username and password, there will be kind of an orange or kind of a green kind of separate window opening, asking me that this is something you're doing securely. You can't do it in a regular browser. You need a secured browser. So it will open up a new web browser with a highlight on all sides of the screen, and which indicates that this is a transport layer security enabled web browser. So that ensures it is temporary. That web browser is temporary. It will, after some time, if you try to access that, it will automatically sign out and kick you out of the session. So those are some measures taken to ensure security. So what happens in this TLS mechanism is, before the client and server start communicating, they perform an automated process called a handshake, where they exchange information about who they are and which secret codes and algorithms they'll use to encode their messages to each other. Then for the duration of the conversation, all the data that passes between the client and server is encrypted. So it is changed to a thing that you can't understand. It is encrypted so that even if somebody doesn't listen it, they won't be able to determine what's being communicated. So TLS is the successor to the secure sockets layer. Okay, so early days this was the technology. Now TLS is the newest technology to the same concept. In addition to TLS handling the encryption part of a secure e-commerce transaction, a digital certificate is assigned to the website to provide positive server verification, so shoppers can be assured of with whom they are dealing. Let me show you one. So if you look at this one, you can see now this website I have accessed, strategyobject.com. You can see this lock sign. So if you have this lock sign, that means in their server where this website is running, they have a digital certificate enabled. So with this, I have a trust that they are using a valid digital certificate and this is a trusted website. So if I click this, I'll be able to see the information about the certificate. So say it says it's a valid certificate. Maybe if I click that further, it will give me information. So now Kaspersky is verifying that. So Kaspersky, since I have installed Kaspersky on my side, Kaspersky has automatically got the details of the certificate and it is telling me that this is a trusted website. So this is what happens to search results also when you're searching for information. Let's say I'm searching for something. Now you can see this green color things. So this is because I have installed Kaspersky. It is going and scanning very basic information from the website and giving me the information that this is a secure. So it means most likely these websites are having a digital certificate, authorized ones. So that's why you get these things. If it is untrusted one, you will get a red color warning not to go, right? So it's better not to go to those websites. And I think one of the sites you shouldn't go is again BIT. They don't have a valid digital certificate. anytime anything can happen there. I don't know why they are still having that unsecured. Okay. Then electronic cash. So this is another mechanism, another modern way of doing transaction without involving physical cash in your hand. This is the future. This is going to happen soon. Electronic cash is an amount of money that is computerized, stored, and used as cash for e-commerce transaction. Typically, consumers must open an account with an electronic cash service provider by providing identification information. When the consumers want to withdraw electronic cash to make a purchase, they access the service provider via the internet and present proof of identity, a digital certificate issued by a certification authority or a username and password. After verifying a consumer's identity, the system debits the consumer's account and credits the seller's account with the amount of the purchase. So it's basically having money online. You are maintaining an account online. The money is not physical, right? So most of the things, like if you later, maybe some of you might have already started an account with these online freelancing platforms, freelancer.com or Fiverr, you will notice that once you do a project, these people pay you money. That money is going to be stored in their platform. It will show you the dollar, or maybe it will be in a Canadian dollar, Australian dollar, depends on what currency it has come through. It is in a, it's like a temporary bank, right? So whenever you need to transfer it to your side, you just have to go and give the relevant details and they will transfer it to your account after deducting some fees, right? So it's e-cash. One example of e-cash is the use of PayPal's beacon. PayPal is again an online payment gateway platform. So PayPal has this beacon, hands-free payments method using PayPal beacon. We already have a brief understanding about beacon in the last class, where I mentioned that beacons provide information, customized information to the customer if they have the Bluetooth enabled. So same idea here. What they do is PayPal is rolling out beacon, a hardware device for merchants that uses Bluetooth technology to improve the shopper's experience. Consumers must download the PayPal app to their smartphone and opt it into the service to use beacon for hands-free check-in and payments. So there are some point of sale systems in the US, I believe, some popular point of sale softwares, Purply, Leaf, Leapset, Micros, all these things. So when beacon customers walk into a store, beacon will trigger a vibration or sound to confirm successful check-in, and their photo will appear on the screen of the merchant's point of sale system so they can be identified. Payment requires only a verbal confirmation and a receipt is emailed to the consumer. Using beacon, a drugstore could fill your prescriptions or your name could be added to a waitlist of tables at the restaurant simply by walking into the establishment. I hope you got the idea. Basically, this is going to avoid a lot of queues. Like, at the moment to enter the premises, let's say if it's a restaurant, let's take this example, restaurant example. Once you enter the restaurant, maybe there will be already information where you're going to sit, which place you're doing. Maybe already you have through their other mobile application, you might have ordered the food. So this is something I also did for my master's degree as a research project. I didn't actually use the term beacon, but the concept is similar. The idea is basically somebody could do their orders remotely, and let's say they want to still go to the particular restaurant and have a nice time sitting at that restaurant and having their meals. So normally these fast food outlets like McDonald's and KFC's, mostly they will be crowded. You have to wait in the queue and do things. Instead of that, why not do the pre-order through the mobile app? And once you reach the particular restaurant or a particular branch, You go to a particular table and you sit there. Once the moment you sit at the table, there will be a notification sent to the reception desk that this person has come, and already the food will be also ready. So it will avoid a lot of these waiting times. So the same concept, but you can do with this beacon, right? A lot of waiting times can be avoided. So there are a lot of usages of this. You can think of this. There are this technology is out there. If you are integrating PayPal system in your mobile solutions or your e-commerce solutions, you can think of this and introducing it to some people. Smartphones. The use of smartphones to make purchases and transfer funds between consumers and businesses has become commonplace. The goal is to make the payment process as simple and secure as possible, and for it to work on many different phones and through many different mobile network providers. These are not simple tasks. Fortunately, the intelligence built into iPhone and other smartphones can make this all possible, right? So your smartphones need to be very robust. When I say robust, steady. It should be able to handle any amount of workload whenever you are doing a transaction. Then these terminologies which we are facing in our life, regular life, credit charge, credit cards, charge cards, debit cards. So we'll see what are these. A credit card such as Visa or MasterCard has a preset spending limit based on the user's credit history. And each month the user can pay all or part of the amount owed. Interest is charged on the unpaid amount. So basically with credit card, sometimes if you are running out of money also, they will provide you a hold. But then again, they will give you a timeline. Most of these banks will give you a deadline to pay the money back within that time. If you don't pay that within the given timeline, maybe you have to pay interest. So that is the issue with the credit card. Another thing, charge card means, such as American Express, carries no preset spending limit, and the entire amount charged to the card is due at the end of the billing period. So here there is no any reservation like you have to spend only 25,000, 30,000. No, you have unlimited kind of thing. There's unlimited amount of spending, but all that will come at the end of the month mostly. You can't carry a balance from month to month with a charge card like you can carry with a credit card. So charge cards require customers to pay in full every month, or they have to do a penalty. Right. So this is the concept behind charge card and credit cards. Debit cards is the, I think, the you know, more customer friendly and more comfortable one in terms of controlling your money. They look like credit cards, but they operate like cash or a personal check. The debit card is linked directly to your savings or checking account. Each time you use the card, money is automatically taken from your checking or savings account to cover the purchase. So bank is not going to take care of the money. It is directly going to, so you don't have to pay interest or anything. The debit card is directly going to deduct from your savings account or current account, right, whatever it is. So that is the credit card. So credit, charge and debit cards currently store limited information about you on a magnetic stripe. This information is read each time the card is swiped to make a purchase, right? This is the old technology, I think, magnetic stripe. Now I think it's not magnetic stripe. You have small chips there, a kind of whatever we are going to discuss about smart cards. A small amount of the smart card functionality is now available in these three types of cards. Smart card is a credit card size device with an embedded microchip. I think we already have seen that now. Even we see it on our national identity card these days. So to provide electronic memory and processing capability. So the limitation in the other three cards are you can't store a lot of information. But now in smart cards, we are trying to store a lot of other additional information. So smart cards can be used for a variety of purposes, including storing a user's financial facts, health insurance data, credit card numbers. A lot of things can be stored, even passwords. They can also store monetary values for spending. smart cards are better protected from misuse than conventional credit card charge and debit card because the smart card information is encrypted. Conventional credit charge and debit cards clearly show your account number on the face of the card. The card number along with the forged signature is all that a thief needs to purchase items and charge them against your card. So the conventional cards, they show the, mostly they show the account number. It is printed, no? It is like, what do you say that, embossed. You have these embossed cards. So you see the account number, maybe on the credit card number, everything is visible. So anybody who wants to steal it, they don't have to worry much. They can just simply memorize it or something. Smart card makes credit theft practically impossible because a key to unlock the encrypted information is required. And there is no external number that a thief can identify and no physical signature a thief can forge, right? So smart card is said to be a little bit secure. So here's a quick comparison. I leave this for you to refer later. So advantage and disadvantage of credit cards. You can go through this in detail. We have already discussed briefly the differences. So mainly I would say credit card, charge card and debit card, they have very limited storage capacity than a smart card. Finally, EMV card. This is a special type of smart card, I believe. In the United States, credit cards with only magnetic stripes are being replaced by cards with chips that employ EMV. What is EMV? European Visa, the very popular card companies. Global standard for working with point of sale systems. So any ATM machine you go, if it supports, it will either support one of these three. Right? So each time the EMV card is used or inserted into a sale device in a supermarket, for example, for payment, it creates a unique transaction code that can never be reused. That means when you are putting the card into the payment swiper, that at that moment a transaction code is generated which is having only one lifetime. That means after that transaction, the same transaction code cannot be used again. So let's say when the transaction code is generated, and if a hacker keeps storing these transaction codes on his end, for some reason he already stores it, but you have finished the transaction successfully. If he tries to use the same transaction code, given that he has got your account number and all, that will not be valid because it is already expired. So that is the advantage, one of the advantages of EMV. Unlike the European version of the card, which requires the user to enter PIN number. So the European version doesn't have this transaction code. You have to manually type a PIN number to complete the transaction. The US card user simply signs the receipt. While such cards are nearly impossible to counterfeit, the account number of these cards is clearly visible and can be used by fraudsters for online purchases. So this PIN number, sometimes it is a one-time PIN number, or sometimes you will get the PIN number in SMS. So when you're doing a transaction, giving your card, the cashier person might ask whether you have received a PIN code, because you are the customer. So then you have to open up your phone and you have to tell the number, they will type in, then only they can be getting or deducting money from your account. So that is the concept of the European version of this card. So these are the technologies of today when it comes to online payment systems and payment methods. So you have to be aware of this. Finally, there is something called P-card. I will leave this aside. I think I haven't organized this properly. Yeah. What does it say? It's a credit card used to streamline the traditional purchase order and invoice payment process. P-card is typically issued to selected employees who must follow company rules and guidelines that may include a single purchase limit, a monthly spending limit, or merchant category. Okay, so it is again another type of a customized ATM card or a loyalty card again, where it might be issued by companies, but they will have certain limitations, like for how much they need to use, and monthly maybe two times, three times only they have to do payments, purchases, something like that. So a very restricted card system, right? And due to an increased risk of unauthorized purchases, each P card holder's spending activities reviewed periodically by someone independent of the card holder to ensure adherence to the guidelines. So P cards are normally, I think, given to these system administrators also in some companies by the CEOs. They will give it to the system administrator because day-to-day operations, a lot of things need to be purchased. Some tools need to be purchased. Always they cannot call the senior management for asking money every time. So what the senior management will do is they will issue a P card with the arrangement with the bank. So they will also give a limit. Okay, for this month, for each month, this is the amount of money that you can spend on a particular purchase. So that is called P card. That concludes the discussion. Any question, any doubts, you can ask quickly. If you didn't understand, I can explain.